So thanks a lot, Stuart. And so I'd like to thank all the organizers for inviting me to give a lecture here. And so I'm very honored to do that. But also, it's very intimidating to to speak in front of true experts like Sorin and for this subfactor committee. Because originally, as you know very well, so I'm outside, so I came from outside in a way. But anyhow, so let me try my best. So, okay, so so as the title says, so what I want to explain is the basics around unitary rigid tensor categories. And yeah, actually, most of the basics are going to be about two categories in unitary setting, and the fundamental things about the actions of those objects on oblate algebras, mostly for normal algebras. So that's the sort of maybe viewpoint, categorical viewpoint. But we did see some sort of more concrete things in Stefan's lecture yesterday. Namely, so we saw some sort of really fundamental things around group actions on for normal algebras, and several things around cocycles, like cocycle actions and also cocycle conjugacies of actions, which we have to take into account when you try to classify such actions. So this is the, they are all formulated in very concrete way, but they might look a bit something out of blue or something a bit, it might be a bit difficult to sort of see the conceptual reasons why you have to do this. So, and hopefully this categorical viewpoint will give you that. And also, so in sort of another direction, so what I want, what I'm going to explain will be, it's going to be a categorical counterpart of the sort of invariant for the classification of subfactors. And so in this direction, there's this celebrated result by Sorin Popa on the something called the classification of amenable injective subfactors. So, and of course, there's no way I can explain the sort of proofs or even strategy of proofs for that. But at least for the invariants you see in this classification, hopefully, we will be able to formulate invariants. So that is another goal, concrete goal coming from the classical results in this theory. But anyhow, so I want to start from sort of a categorical viewpoint and gradually sort of try to reduce these categorical data to such classical invariants or structures. So the as we saw in the title, the categorical structure we want to look at is something called unitary two categories. And let's start with the unitary category. So that's the like result two, and it's gonna be something easier. So it's given by it is a category, and that means you want to look at a system or a collection of objects. I mean, those are, of course, in concrete setting, those are going to be some concrete mathematical objects, but you can, for the moment, treat them as some formal symbols or labels. So capital X, capital Y are going to be my labels. And the having unitary structure on the category or C-star structure means having some nice structure on the morphism sets. So on objects, collection of objects, we don't really assume anything, but on morphism sets, we put C-star structure, which means, first of all, the endomorphism rings are going to be C-star algebras. So you have norm and star structure making these rings, first of all, so the morphism sets are complex vector spaces. That's implicit always. And the endomorphism rings are C-star algebras. And so these are like diagonals in a way. And the off-diagonals, generic morphism sets become Hilbert modules. So What do I mean by that? For example, if you have two morphisms from X to Y, say, then you can take something like S star T for two morphisms from X to Y. And so this will be something in CX again. And that's going to be my inner product. So I guess, so this kind of formula is something you see quite often. So when you try to do something like modules over C-star algebras with some sort of nice inner product. So, and in a way, making sense of this formula is really the real job you have to carry out in concrete setting. But anyhow, so this is something we want to put. And also, I am assuming direct sum operations. So this is also implicit. And well, so I don't think I want to say too much, but for example, if you have projections in these C-star algebras, endomorphism rings C-star algebras, then those projections define direct summons of objects. Okay, so that's the something like the sort of vector spaces to if vector spaces to algebras if the two categories are like algebras. Okay, and so let's go ahead to the fundamental definition we want to care about. The so that's the unitary two category. And to be precise, non-strict two categories. So maybe it's better to go by category, but anyhow, so I'm sticking to this. So it's a matter of convention. And for that, so we are sort of making it sort of one level higher if you want, but anyhow, so it's going to be still very concrete. So like we had objects before, so we are having some kind of symbols called zero cells. Let's call them IJK, so on. And for each pair of these symbols or zero cells, we want unitary categories, so C-star categories, like we saw before. And it's again just a sort of matter of nomenclature, but you say the objects of these categories are one cells from I to J. So pictorially, you can represent them by arrows between two points representing two zero cells. And morphisms between these objects or one cells are called two cells. So pictorially, it's again something like you have two arrows with the same endpoints, and there's some kind of thicker arrow between them. So that's a pictorial presentation. But yeah, anyway, so I don't think I am going to need too much of this pictorial notation. So this is more to sort of help you when you see similar structures elsewhere. And the important thing is, so you have some kind of horizontal composition of one cells. So the morphisms or two cells, they compose because they are by division morphisms in categories, but I can also compose one cells. And so that's called monoidal structure here. So if you sort of want to make it formally, then so I have a bifunctor from Cij times Cjk to Cik. So these zero cells behave like some kind of indexes for matrices. And so this operation is natural. So when you have morphisms between X and X prime state, then you get a morphism from X tensor Y to X prime tensor Y. And all that. And we also want units, tensor units, in each sub diagonal category CII. So I think I am going to write this as CI later. All right. And well, so we are not done. Sorry. So these sort of product operations should satisfy some kind of consistency or associativity condition. So I guess you have at least heard of something called associator on tensor categories. Oops. Oh, sorry. Oh, I have to be careful. And the so if you have three things, and of course you want to have composable triples, so x, y, z, and so x is from ci, y. Sorry, x is from Cij, y is from Cjk, and z is from Ckl, then, well, so you can take their product. But so there are two ways. I mean, so either take product of x and y first, or take the product of y and z first. And so we don't want to say that these are on the north equal, but just comparable in some sort of consistent way. And so there's a consistency condition called pentagon equation for this. So when you have four composable things, then so you can move parentheses using these associators. And so there are two different looking ways to move parentheses around four product of four things. But well, so you don't want to distinguish them. Okay, so that's the two-category or non-strict two-category. Yeah, so let me go through some sort of fundamental examples of two-categories, unitary two-categories we see in operator algebra or subfactor theory, to be exact. So that's the category of bimodules over polynomial algebras. Of course, if you are looking for sensible examples, then so those polynomial algebras want to come with faithful traces, so finite algebras, and even finite factors often. So those are going to be my labels for zero cells. And the one cells are going to be Hilbert bimodules, so just Hilbert spaces with normal representations of these algebras, commuting normal representations. And having category of bimodules, of course, the natural choice of morphisms between one cells just bimodule homomorphisms. And then, so the horizontal composition, so monoidal product operation is something called confusion. So morally speaking, you want to define balanced tensor product of bimodules. But because we want Hilbert spaces everywhere, so you want to do you want to take some nice subspace of vectors and deal with that. Okay, and another more convenient example in practice is something called the homomorphism category. So for properly infinite polynomial algebras, this is actually easier to work with, because instead of bimodules, you can talk about concrete homomorphisms between polynomial algebras. So I'm afraid I have to be a bit quick. So let's not sort of spend too much time on that, because in any case, so these objects are equivalent to some bimodules between properly infinite polynomial algebras. So for this one, anyhow, the formulas might be a bit tricky once if you see it for the first time. So the labels are like as before, but one cells are star homomorphisms. Normal star homomorphisms, I guess, and non-unital star homomorphisms, and the two cells are something called intertwiners, and I guess it's better to admire this intertwining equation, intertwining relation. So it's going to be an element of the target algebra that sort of intertwines the homomorphisms in this sense. So it might look a bit strange, but this really does the right job as the morphisms between one cells. For example, you can compose just in the target algebra as take the product of elements. That's going to be compositional morphisms. And monoidal structure is defined like this. So first of all, product of homomorphisms are really usual compositional homomorphisms. And you need to define monoidal product of morphisms or two cells, but that's defined basically by these formulas. So yeah, and so you can check that these formulas define intertwined subfactor composition morphisms, so, and satisfy the conditions for the monoidal product. So for this one, it's really strict, so there's no associator. Anyhow, having sort of looked at the concrete examples, let me go back to a bit more abstract thing. And the unitary two categories or unitary tensor categories on their own are a bit too general because they correspond to something like semigroups. And we want something a bit closer to groups. And so that's where this duality comes into play. And so this is also very nice framework to do dimension theory on two categories. So let's say C is our unitary two category. And let's take one cell, so object in this category Cij for some ij. And dual of x, well, to be precise, maybe dual in the unitary sense, is given by these data. So it's a bit complicated, but anyhow, bear with me. So there's underlying one cell, so call it X bar. But of course, so it's not unique. So it's only unique up to isomorphism of objects. And also structure morphisms. So that's two morphisms, both from tensor unit to the monoidal product of X and this dual object X bar. And you want some consistency condition, which looks like evaluation and co-evaluation maps for purely algebraic setting. Anyhow, so concretely, you can use the star structure, so the on morphisms, and get the composition looking like this picture. If you know these pictorial presentation of morphisms in monoidal categories. And formally speaking, you just take this, a bit long composition, but still something just using the structure morphisms in two category and these morphisms. And so I want this to be identity. So, okay. It's particularly nice when you have simple tensor units, simple monoidal units. So, let's say we have monoidal units, which are simple in this sense. So the endomorphism rings are one dimensional. So otherwise you might start getting some kind of direct sum decomposition, which we don't want to care too much. Anyhow, do I see something in chat? Okay, yeah, I hope that's settled.
Yeah, I think so. It seems to.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Sorry. Yeah, thanks. Yeah, thanks for the help. And I think I forgot to put, but the rigid two categories are the ones where you can always find dual. Sorry. So I thought I put that somewhere. But anyhow, yeah, sorry. So rigid means any X has dual. Okay. And yeah, so that's the sort of precise framework we want to work with. And to be precise, this one. So rigid categories with simple monoidal units. So those are the ones. So you can guess, but any sort of defined choice of these data are isomorphic to each other. So you can always sort of compare defined choices up to isomorphism objects. But the a bit tricky thing is the choice of AO and AO bar, it had some ambiguities. For example, the stupid ambiguity is something like scaling AO by some factor and rescaling AO bar by the inverse factor. So you want to normalize the choice. For example, one trick you can play is take the norm equal. And well, if you think about it a bit more, so if you take sort of product with some non-unitary morphism and its inverse on sort of both sides, then so it's going to increase norms. So you want to make the most efficient choice of that. To answer Aaron's question, I just put the definition of rigidity for two category here. So two categories rigid when any object or when any one cell has dual. Okay, so all right, and let's go back to that. So if the monoidal units are simple, then so this minimization game has very nice answer. So first of all, so you can define something called categorical dimension or intrinsic dimension using the sort of minimization game over all solutions of this conjugate equation or duality equation, and just look at the product of norms. So this way you are sort of balancing all the stupid ambiguities. And so for the minimizing solution of this condition, you have something called sphericity. So you can start taking these kind of compositions. So in pictures or in formulas, it's going to be like this. And a priori, there's no way to sort of expect that these two formulas are equal. And if you really choose arbitrary solutions to the duality equation, you cannot hope for that. For example, this is sensitive to rescaling one factor by something and scaling down the other. But for the minimizing solution with these balanced norms, you actually have equality. So that's a great discovery by Longo and Roberts in their paper about the dimension of tensor categories. And so these formulas even define trace functionals on these C-star algebras. Sorry. So and this is the endomorphism ring, if it's not clear. All right, and so the even greater thing is, so the categorical dimension defined this way, just using minimization game, so it really so qualifies as a dimension. So if you have direct sum, you get sum of dimension, and for the monoidal product, it spits out the product of dimensions. So, I mean, this is by definition some positive number. Okay. And so this is basically the only proof I'm giving you today. So, and it's a bit, it's very elementary, but still, I think it sort of deserves mention. So just out of these conditions, so I get some kind of estimate on these trace functionals looking like Pimsner Popa estimate for indexes. Anyhow, so it's very concrete. So let's see what it means. So take a. What am I doing? It's CIJ. Take one cell or object in these categories and take a positive element in endomorphism ring. And then the trace functional on this positive element gives me really a positive number with a bound from below by these concrete numbers. So you get the inverse of dimension times norm. So, and the proof isn't too difficult once you know what you are looking for. The important thing is to find a projection in the sort of amplified endomorphism ring. So to be precise, in C, JJ. Something like x times x bar. So C, II, sorry. Just because the dimension was defined as the product of the norm of R and R bar. But so now we are taking the balanced solution. So for example, R star R, that gives me dimension, or R bar star R bar, that also gives me dimension. As yeah, and well, oh sorry, I might have screwed that. So there might be some factor of square, but anyway, it's okay. And the so because you have a projection, so you can sandwich something like projection times another element, and T commutes with this projection in the bigger endomorphism ring. So take the projection times T and sandwich with this completely positive map. That is sandwiching by R bar star and R bar. And then, so it gives me some estimate. So it's very simple trick, just with sort of positivity and complete positivity and all that. And so the right formula gives me, on the nose, it gives me dx inverse times t, but because t is positive and the left-hand side is scalar, so it gives me estimate by norm also. So I have a question about the sphericity. Good point, but so basically for a unitary setting, you are forced to have sphericity. So I'm afraid basically you don't find non-spherical categories in non-unitary setting. So, and well, so I don't really have like very nice conceptual sounding answer for this sphericity of bimodules. So this is something you can get for something. Maybe. So this is important point to sort of remind for the bimodule category. So we are talking about the categorical traces coming from solution to conjugate equation. So you can embed morphisms into these tracial algebras if you are working with bimodules over tracial algebras. But the restriction of trace on the sort of coefficient algebra might not be these categorical traces. So generally, you have to be a bit careful about that. But anyhow, let me go ahead. And the consequence of this sort of estimate of trace on positive elements by is norm times dx inverse uniform factor is that the these endomorphism have to be finite dimensional. So you can always have same simplicity out of this setting. Because finite dimensional system algebras have decomposition of unit by minimal projections. And minimal projections give you reducible objects. Okay. So hopefully we will get to a bit non-trivial definition around these unitary two categories. So that is the amenability. So uh, And for that, so I want to compare this categorical dimension with something more combinatorial. And for that, so I want to forget most of the structures about these unitary two categories, but just remember the combinatorial part. And what is that? So let's work with unitary rigid two categories, so which we know to be semi-simple now. And because we have the semi-simplicity, so we can just look at the list of reducible classes in decomposable objects and their isomorphism classes. And any one cell gives you bounded operator on the little L2 of these reducible classes, basically by the decomposition of decomposition of monoidal product into reducible objects, and just look at the multiplicities you see there. And one of the standard for matrices with dimension estimate gives you something like the operator norm of this gamma x is bounded by this dx, but generally it might not be equal. Okay, so when they are equal, so we say that the unitary rigid two category C is amenable. All right, so the there are several standard reductions you can do. For example, amenability defined like this is equivalent to amenability of any corner that is going to be a monoidal category, unitary rigid monoidal category. And also, if you are looking at pointed categories, so the fusion rule really looked like a discrete group. In that case, more or less by definition, you see amenability of this group. So, it's one of the definitions. So you see, something like convex combination of translations on regular representation, and you want to see the sum of coefficients. Okay. So, right. I wasn't sure if I can cram this in during the lecture. So I have until 22, right?
Yeah, but you dropped out for a little bit. So let's go on, let's.
Okay, yeah, you are being very generous. But yeah, so let's not spend too much time. I think this might be some sort of nice thing to explore during Q&A session, if some of you are interested in it. So these two category structures are sort of strongly coupled to something called formulation algebra objects. And first of all, without rigidity, so duality for objects, so what you see is something, some kind of bimodules. So tensor categories are like rings, and the CIJs are a bit like Morita equivalence context, so bimodules with nice properties. So, for example, first of all, these monoidal categories are diagonal act on these CIJs. And also, you can recover the sort of, for example, CJ, so one of the coefficients from just one-sided action of CI on CIJ. So this is a consequence of rigidity. So this is from rigidity. So I post this as a question, but so the sort of wisdom from these monoidal category theories, when you have something like this module category or bimodule category, you should try to sort of internalize these structures and just try to capture these structures in one of these diagonal corners. And after all, so that is really related to subfactors. So when you look at the bimodule categories, for example. I don't want to spend too much time, but that is doable. So you can internalize these module categories. That is the I guess you can trace it back to Ostrich's result. That was in the context of fusion categories. But basically, looking at his formulation, you can play the same game and try to sort of find algebra objects in your monoidal category sitting in some corner that gives you module categories like this. So to be precise, without the finiteness assumption like Ostrich was working, you want some kind of proper actions. Or else you go out of monoidal category. But still, in many cases, you can make sense of the formal expression giving you this internal endomorphism. And another wisdom is from Muga. So this Ostrich duality only gives you some kind of internalization of module categories. But for rigid two category, so you expect some kind of extra structure on this algebra. And that is something called Frobenius algebra. So in our unitary setting, it means the star adjoint of product map is a bimodule homomorphism. So that is actually related to some kind of C star algebra with phase four state. Again, so this is a bit of value and general correspondence, but in many concrete settings, you can really substantiate this. So the general algebras give you module categories, but if you want something with nice duality, then you are really looking at something like C-star algebra. Anyhow, let me come to the sort of the second ingredient in the title. So we are now done with rigid unitary two category, but then we also want to understand the actions of the two categories on operator algebras. So this is something that gradually sort of came about. So there are many precursors I cannot really mention, but sort of in this formulation, I guess. Something you can find in recent work of Tomatsu. So let's say you have a unitary two category, and then action of such two category on operator algebra is actually more like action on a family of operator algebras labeled by zero cells. As it's defined, it's very sort of simple and elegant, I think. It's just a two category, unitary two category functor from C to bimodule category with doing the right thing on zero cells. And free action is just free phase four functor. So in other words, if you look at the image bimodules and look at the bimodule homomorphisms, all bimodule homomorphisms come from C. That's the sort of correct way to package freeness. So let me unpack the ingredients here. So first of all, I should say at the step zero, I have a correspondence between zero cells and fundamental algebras. But so after that, I have bimodules for each one cell. And for each two cell or morphism in this category Cij, I have bimodule homomorphisms. And also, another part of the structure is the comparison of monoidal products. So you can take a monoidal product either in C or as bimodule. And we saw for associators, they don't have to be equal on the nodes. I mean, that's a bit too much to ask. But we have some kind of comparison with consistency. And if you write down this consistency condition with associators, you basically get two cocycle relation. So this is the moral reason why you want to take cocycle actions. because if you look at, if you formulate things in categorical way, then free action of pointed category gamma bar, so that's the, so gamma as a monoidal category, so just use the product rule in gamma as the monoidal product with a trivial associator. That's the outer cocycle action of gamma on M. So now we are talking about monoidal category, so there's just one zero cell. Okay, and there are several like immediate restrictions you get. For example, if you look at the category, if you look at rigid category and its action on fundamental algebras, you basically from the structure morphism for duality in C, you get finite index pi modules and or finite index homomorphisms for properly infinite modules. All right, and let me sort of try to get to the sort of correspondence with subfactor theory, but the categorical counterpart is really again simple. So so what you see there is a singly generated two category. So in other words, there's just one generating object or one generating one cell. So that means I just want two zero cells, call them zero and one, and something in orthogonal category that generates everything. And yes, the formal meaning of that is take monoidal product of X and X bar. So because we are looking at rigid two category, X bar should be there also, and take the monoidal product of X and X bar in all possible ways. But then, so you have to take alternating choice of X and X bar and anything embeds in this for long enough expression. Yeah, so this is the definition of single generation. Correct. So this is really the sort of categorical counterpart of John Stower. So you try to look for some kind of generator, some relation presentation. And yeah, so this is something that happened way before. So these two categorical formulation was sorted out. And so this is a bit tricky issue. So many people worked on these classification theory. And so there was a proposal by Ocneanu to understand sort of invariants for subfactors called paragroups and flat connections. That is encoding of fusion graph and also something called 6J symbols in this two categorical setting. So matrix coefficients of associators. So that's the paragroup and flat connection. What went into actual classification theorem by Sorin. So this is something called lambda lattice. It's a formulation of formulation of this structure in terms of these finite dimensional endomorphisms and these categorical traces. You are helping us, but hopefully we will see something in the slides. Or by Von Jones. If there was something called shaded planar algebra, and it is an axiomatization of these morphism spaces from tensor unit to these tensor powers of X bar and X. And then, so all the possible operations you can do from duality structure morphisms. Hopefully I will get to say something. So for amenable two categories, acting on amenable algebras, you have some kind of classification theorem. So in this formulation, again, this is in paper of Tomatsu, but he drew quite a lot on Sorin's work on classification and endomorphism of properly infinite algebras. So anyhow, so what does it say? So take amenable unitary rigid two category and free action on injective factors. And then, so they are unique. Of course, up to some natural isomorphism unitary two factors. So let's unpack that and call it off. So, this part is again very standard. So you try to compare all the ingredients that comes into two category factors. And then, so you basically draw diagrams. And so if you work with that, what you see is a one core cycle. So this is the sort of correct analog of classification of outer actions of amenable groups on injective factors by Ocneanu. Yeah, so really sorry, but I should be stopping now. So for if the unitary two categories from a discrete group, and so you basically recover Ocneanu's classification of amenable group actions on injective factors. And for, I guess we saw some questions in the chat, but for subfactors, injective subfactors with amenable standard invariants, so amenable two category standard invariant. So that is the classification theorem by Sorin. And for that generator is this L2M bigger algebra of L2 of the bigger algebra as a sort of bimodule of itself and a smaller one. And also you can, there are many precursors. For example, for something looking like groups, so there was a discrete amenable quantum group actions in the spirit of Ocneanu. That was by Masuda and Tomatsu. And yeah, so I'm kind of regretting putting that, but anyhow, so there's a recent announcement by Arano about the classification of fusion categories on QFPARC algebras with some kind of Rockling property. But anyhow, so that's so I guess so these are more sort of suggestive or other connections. So let's not spend too much time. And so if any of you are interested, let's talk about this in the Q&A. Okay, thanks a lot.